Comic books. They have given us iconic figures, role models, and entertainment throughout the ages. Millions of comics are made each year, and thousands of people still read them today. In this documentary, we'll be examining exactly how this thin paper book began. We'll be examining the golden age of comic books. Comics themselves have been around near the creation of the printing press, in 1440. However, the first modern comic strip wasn't published until October 18, 1896. It was called The Yellow Kid by Richard Alcott. It's considered the first modern comic due to Mr. Alcott's innovation to have successive dialogue and successive imagery. Before this point, comic books may have had successive dialogue or imagery, but never both at the same time. This innovation gave off a sense of real-life events. The next big step was also Alcott's creation. He invented live dialogue, or the exchange of words between two characters on a page. This helped create the sense of time passing. It took comics from simply viewing them to reading them. The next innovation was done by a man named Henry Conway Fisher. He created the strip, or the borders around the events. It first appeared November 15th, 1907. This simple design helped increase the readability of comics due to the fact that it clearly distinguished one panel from another. This helped lead to the next big leap in comics, varying panel sizes, created by Winsor McCay. He used different sized panels to create scenes and focus on certain events or motions. By 1896, Pulp Magazine, an early comic title, was the most popular fiction around, specializing in mystery and science fiction. One major factor for its success was that it was cheap to buy due to the pulp, grain-like paper that it was printed on. Publisher Frankie Muncie thought up this idea.
The story is worth more than the paper it is printed on. Frankie Muncie.
In 1929, the U.S. fell into a Great Depression, and much like the nation, comic books change. The nation didn't want to laugh or dream of space. They wanted a hero, and comic book companies could abide. Characters like Buck Rogers and Tarzan hit the shelves that same year. And then he came. Superman. Jerry Siegel and Joe Shuster, the creators of Superman, comprised many different elements from previous characters, like Zorro and the Shadow. When they were finished, they sent off copies to different syndicates. For 6 years, Superman hung in limbo. No one would print him. It wasn't until June 1938 that he was printed in Action Comics number 1. The sad thing was, he was just a filler character, only put there because the company didn't have another one. The creators had a lot invested in this character. In fact, they had created an alternate character back in school on their homemade pulp magazine, Science Fiction number 3, in 1929. This character had the same powers and similar story that of Superman. This character that had been developing for 9 years was used as a filler. The buyers, however, had a different view of the Man of Steel. Action Comics number 1 flew off the shelf. Originally, the company wrote this off as a fluke, and they didn't bring back Superman until the 7th issue. Soon they learned it wasn't Action Comics, but rather Superman that they wanted. Action Comics number 1, with the first printing of Superman, is the turning point of comic book history. That's because Superman was the first superhero, a template, if you will, for those to follow. He redefined American heroics by displaying an average man with extraordinary power. Superman gave the United States something it desired, a hope of surviving through the Depression. Soon every company was making their own Superman. All American Comics created the Green Lantern. Fawcett Publishing created Captain Marvel. The list goes on and on.
Superman was popular. Like, I mean, like, you know, it's... Like, look at it now. Like, what is, like, the number one gaming franchise in the world right now? It's Call of Duty. And, for better or worse, you know, every company is trying to make their own Call of Duty. Either be Medal of Honor, or, like, Spec Ops, or, you know... There's so many different, like, military shooters out there. So imagine, like, back in, like, the 1930s, like, this company comes out of nowhere, creates Superman, and they're like, oh, like, this is selling, like, millions of dollars. Like, let's go make our own. And, like, they make Captain Marvel, there's the Sentry, there's all these other different characters. And then, like, after a while, though, it's like, you know, you get, like, people start making, like, their own different stuff. Like, you get a Captain America, you get a Batman. You know, all these different kinds of heroes.
Some got too close to the original, however, like Wonder Man, who first appeared in Wonder Comics number 1 in 1939 by Fox Features. Fox got sued so quick that Wonder Man wasn't even able to appear in Wonder Comics number 2. As time went on, real life came into play again. By 1940, we were confronted with a real supervillain, Hitler. Our nation, still deep in a depression, was craving for a hero. With this, Joe Simon and Jack Kirby were presented with an interesting task. They already had their villain, Hitler. They were to create a hero, an anti-Hitler, a Captain America. The project was rushed because they were worried that Hitler would die before they were finished, dropping its price. In March 1941, Timely Comics released Captain America number 1. The front picture displayed Captain America hitting Hitler square across the face. It became known as one of the most political comic book covers in history.
We weren't at war yet, but everyone knew it was coming. That's why Captain America was born. America needed a super patriot, Jack Kirby.
Captain America's style spread like wildfire, much like what happened to Superman. Soon, every hero began fighting the Axis powers, or encouraging people to buy war bonds. Captain America continued the Superman ideal. With this new threat, he was yet another person of American heroics, yet another average man doing amazing things. He and Superman made comics more than simple books. They made it a symbol, a beacon of what America was and could be again. It united people on this idea that they will endure and thrive in strife, the very thing that defined our country upon its birth. The last major change in the Golden Age was done by Jack Kirby. He successfully mixed realistic and abstract art. This turned out to be the ideal setting for superheroes, who were seemingly teetering on fact and fantasy. All heroes soon lived in this setting. With the end of World War II came the end of the Golden Age. People no longer needed a hero figure. Comics were selling, but not in such ample amounts. Some characters, like the Green Lantern, went into hiatus. Others, like the American Crusader, are all but forgotten. So now you know how it all started. But this is just a mere fraction of the history of comic books. Don't worry, though. To learn more, all you have to do is flip through the pages.